visible you are in front of people, the more your foibles are evident for others to see. This might be why some people don't go to small groups, stay away from places where they'll get close. Some people like to go to the mega church because in the mega church you can go and you can hide. It's harder to hide here at Crestline First Baptist. So one of the things, here's one of the secrets. If you don't want to connect, go out during the last song, right? Come in after the first song starts, because it's kind of like harder to bother you. Okay? In the small church, it's kind of easier to see Junior's here today, right? And that Naomi's getting ready for the birth tomorrow, going into the hospital tomorrow, right? So it's kind of like easy to see her, and that their sister's with, that Naomi's sister, if you can't tell, look, okay, sister, right? Then Naomi's sister is here, so she's probably getting ready to help also, okay? So it's kind of like just easy, you can't hide. It's like some of you thought there was a mirror up here on the platform today, right? And you wondered, how is that mirror working? Because like the mirror has stripes, but over here is burgundy or whatever we call that, Bobby. Something like that. And it's because some of you didn't know that Bobby has an alter ego. and the alter ego came today. No, actually, you're the older one, aren't you? Supposedly, so we don't really know for sure. David, his twin brother, they both go to the University of Irvine, University of California at Irvine. Is that how you say it? University of California at Irvine. They're both studying way too hard. Chemistry and all, they're both going to be neurosurgeons or research doctors or something like that. If you're not praying for them, you probably won't pray for anybody. Together is really needed with the kind of hard work that they're doing with their studies and all. But Bobby, our worship leader, who grew up here with David, the two of them on this worship team and all, and we're glad to have you here. But see, you can't hide, can you? Now, one of the things that it's, like Bobby said this morning, he was telling to the worship team, he says, since I'm the leader, then people don't know when I mess up, because you just think that I'm leading. It's the rest of us who look like we're messing up, right, Bobby? So we don't ever mess up, do we? Okay, so I'm at the Transformation Ministries Conference. That's our association of churches, former American Baptists of the Pacific Southwest. It's about 180 or so churches. And we're at the conference, and several of us were there this year. And while we're at the conference, Brian, who is the junior high pastor from Pomona First Baptist Church, a mega church, is the MC. And during one of the breaks, he's going around with a camera and a microphone and doing goofy kind of interview. The challenge was, he's right in the middle of the hallway where all the exhibits are. And as he's doing this, Pastor Bill has to get to the men's restroom. Now, the challenge with getting to the men's restroom is that you have to go through all of the exhibits to the far side of the building, because the women are over here. Of course, now, if they're over there, then they got to get back all the way through to this one. So I'm trying, I got to get to the restroom. And I see Brian is doing interviews. I'm like, oh no, I can't stop. Don't stop. So on the video that morning or later that he shows, I think it was at the end of the week or something, like he's showing all the people on the video, right? And it shows this guy with a beard rushing right past him and cutting him off. And he says, oh, just cut me off. And like, thanks a lot. It's all over the news now. Pastor Bill, he's like rude and inconsiderate when he goes to the bathroom. Okay. I mean, and I know that sometimes that can actually happen to me here on a Sunday morning, especially when it's already 10:16, and I'm supposed to be up on the platform saying, welcome, and somebody wants to stop me. Do anybody know what stress is? None of you do, huh? Okay, well, that's one of my stress moments, is trying to get up to the platform, and I'm already supposed to be up there and supposed to be saying something, and I'm supposed to be saying welcome, and so because of that, I don't welcome you. Yeah, some of you are not laughing with a, you're laughing with that, you know, that other kind of smile, like, you know, yeah, we know, you've done it to us. Thanks. See, the more public you are, the more public your sins are, right? And people are aware of them. And the fact is, if you live with anybody, parent, husband, wife, neighbor, roommate, if you live with anybody, guess what? Somebody sees your faults. Somebody may know them fairly well. It's hard to hide them. We're going to look at a text this morning that encourages us to do something with our faults. The word is to confess them one to another. And here's what I found. Most of us don't like to do that. Most of us prefer to wear a mask where we put on, you know, this persona, right? I mean, come on, let's face it. If we all came in here the way we got up this morning, we'd all have bad breath, we'd all look kind of a little bit odd, and, you know, people would be kind of staying away, right? And so what? Well, we do different things. We decorate ourselves, right? We clean our clothes, and we do things to try to present ourselves so that we will be acceptable to others. In the process, we're wearing a mask that's going to hide or attempt to hide our faults. But guess who you can't hide your faults from? Well, not only the person you live with, but the Lord Jesus Christ, who knows us. He knows the things that we think in our secret places. He knows what you're saying to yourself when you're driving down the road, because some of us aren't saying it quietly enough. He knows the attitudes that we have, and here's the challenge. He knows our sins we try to hide. He knows the stuff that we're doing. According to statistics, the amount of pornography that people are viewing because the internet, even by Christ followers, is horrible. Men and women. The things we say when we're not here, it's funny how language changes when you're outside this building. What was that? iPhone, what was that? Amy, help us out. The Lord knows when we're taking, and here's one of our sins, when we're taking something somebody else has shared with us in confidence, and we're talking about it with someone else, the Lord knows. The Lord knows when we're being critical, even though we never said a word. When we're criticizing things, someone else, why'd they do it that way? Look at the way they, look at the way, all the pointing of fingers. See, the Lord hears and knows all of that. It's interesting. That's why Jesus said things like, if you've thought it, you've committed the sin. Now, what's interesting about that one is he used the illustration of adultery. Oh, my. That means when we're looking at pornography, we are doing what? Adultery. We are committing adultery. Whoa. That's if you're married. If you're not married, oh, you're off the hook, right? No, you're committing fornication. What in the world is that? Sex without marriage. And you're imagining that. So, and fortunately, none of you have that kind of problem, right? But what problems do you have? What are those hidden things that you know it? And here's how you know it. Some of the way you know it, because it shames you. Because you do it more than once. And you yourself look at yourself and say, ah, you did it again. Why do you keep doing that? And you actually start to whip yourself at times. You know, those are some of those hidden sins, those things that we conceal. when I was doing my doctoral dissertation, I went to for an examination, and the committee that I met with said, you know, Bill, and one gentleman is from an Anglican background, he says, you know, Catholics have a problem with the evangelical view of demons. Really? He says, yes. Their concern is that evangelicals tend to use demons as an excuse. Oh, I had a demon of lust attacking me, and that's why I was thinking about that. I had a demon of gossip attacking me, and so that's why I was talking about that person. I had a demon of dissent. I had a demon of whatever, and we like put all the blame on the demon. So then you ask somebody, pray for the demon to be cast out, and they pray, or you pray, and you know, in the name of Jesus Christ, be gone, and there. Now, what just happened? You didn't deal with the fact that it probably wasn't a demon at all. She says, for Catholics, we see evangelicals using casting out of demons as kind of like a form of confession, which is what they're saying. Look, you go to the confessional to do what? To admit sin. The problem is, if we're blaming it on a demon, when frankly it's us, then we're not facing the sin, are we? And maybe that's why the attachment, if we want to call it that, continues. Maybe that's why the battle continues on, because we're not confessing. Well, you know what? I'm giving you what the scripture says, so let's look at it. James chapter 5, verses 13 to 16. It's a very important passage. James has been talking about suffering in the church. And he says, we're supposed to even, in chapter 1, he says, we're supposed to count it all joy. Yeah, right, uh-huh. Count it all joy when you suffer. Now, how many of you really look forward to suffering? I know some of you are masochists or something like that. You want pain. You know, it's kind of fun to have that hurt. Okay, look, there's people who right now are dying for Jesus Christ. It's like the person who says, you know, I'm going to be a bomber and I'm going to go kill myself. And what do they believe? That somehow they're going to get some closer place to God, some closer place in heaven, because they've done a suicide bombing. Whoa. And there's that kind of sense of, you know, they're thinking that is a joyful thing. Okay, that's not the context of James. James is talking about Christians who are suffering and dying for their faith simply because they believe that Jesus died and rose from the dead, and they're sharing that with other people. And there are people who are being severely persecuted right now simply because they believe in Jesus Christ. No other reason. Call themselves a Christ follower. And they're being persecuted. And those are the people that James is saying, count it joy. Count it joy. Recognize that God's with you when you're in the suffering. So that's kind of context for James. So we come then to James chapter 5 and verse 13. And he says, is any one of you in trouble? Then he should pray. Is anyone happy? Let him sing songs of praise. Is any one of you sick? He should call the elders of the church to pray over him and anoint him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise him up. If he has sinned, he will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous man is powerful and effective. The word there is any one of you in trouble? It's the word for, are you suffering? Are you hurting? Are you struggling? Are you in some kind of pain? And there's all different kinds of forms of that, right? You can be in pain and it has nothing to do with your physical body. You can be in emotional pain. You can be physically challenged but emotionally stressing out. Like, y'all were excited going to the ACT yesterday, right? Since you're well prepared, calm, cool, and collected, right? You know, totally peaceful, right? Yeah, there's some emotional stuff going on there, isn't there, when you're preparing for a test or a court hearing or some other kind of experience, or the boss is there and he's saying, you're not doing it right, or whatever, right? And so there's suffering. He's saying, are you suffering? Are you in pain right now? Because if you're suffering, then what James says is pray. Talk to God. Converse with him. Remember, I want to remind you that the reason why we're going through this whole series on prayer is because God wants a relationship with you. The reason to pray is because God wants to have a personal relationship with you. The reason for praying is not because we got to talk God into doing things. Somehow twist his arm, you know, cuddle up next to him and, oh, come on, Jesus, please do this for me. No, no. The reason for prayer is because God wants a closer relationship with us. And in order for us to have that relationship, he wants to sit down and talk with us. Listen to us. And don't forget, for a relationship really to be mutual, he wants to have us listen to him. See, that's why prayer is not all about just running in there, God, I need this, 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 and this, thank you in Jesus' name, amen, goodbye. Prayer is not like I used to pray my prayers when I went to bed as a little boy. And you know, now lay me down to sleep, I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I should die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take. Amen, Jesus, okay, good night. What? A bill? Back then it was Willie. But Willie, you know, could we talk? No. I was just trying to pray before he went to sleep. Trying to get this done with. And some of us are doing prayer like that. And Jesus said, no, look, prayer is about a relationship with me. Let's talk. That's why you'll notice we do that, trying to try to give you some time like that. In most worship times, a time to be silent. And during that silent time, I hope you're not just doing the talking. But sometimes you're doing the listening. Because God wants a personal relationship with you. So when you are suffering, when you encounter difficulties, when things are hard for you, is prayer your first response? When you're in trouble, when something's going bad, when maybe and even physically and something's happening, what's your first thought? Quick, get to the doctor or quick, get to Jesus? What's your first response when you're hurting? Secondly, James says, when you are happy, sing praises. What if I can't sing? Do it anyways, okay? Do it in the shower where you can make lots of noise and who cares who hears you. Psalm 103 verse 2 says, don't forget God's benefits, but sing praise to him. In fact, to the Israelites, he said, when you get to the promised land and you're going into the land and you're taking over land that you didn't do anything to earn and you're taking over buildings that you didn't build and you're taking over fields that you didn't plant, when you get into that promised land where you've gotten all this stuff that you don't deserve, stop and give thanks. Stop and sing praise to the Lord. You see, praise is not about us somehow. We got, oh, this God sitting up here, and he's like, come on now, brag on me, or I'm not going to bless you. You know, come on, you got to pump me up, build my ego, and then I'll think about what I'm going to do for you. That is not what praise is about. You see, the point of praise is not, again, about trying to somehow build the ego of a God that's somehow not ego enough. Oh, right. So somehow, you know, well, we got to tell him he's really wonderful because he didn't know it, he forgot. Really? No, God knows what he's offering to us. The point of praise is to draw us into his presence. It's to get us out of here. Because as we start to praise, and you can see this, haven't you? When you come to worship and you really open up your heart and you really start to praise God, even sing if you're not a singer, that when you start to acknowledge who God is, it's starting to change your thoughts. That's the point of it. To get you out of the circumstances, out of the stuff that you're in, whatever's going on, and enjoy God. It's to draw us into his presence. See, we have it wrong if we think that praise is, you know, somehow, okay, well, I got to pay him his homage, you know. Okay, God, you're wonderful. I mean, come on. Do you really like it when somebody's sitting there saying, okay, tell me I'm wonderful. Tell me I'm wonderful. Oh, you know, tell me more. You know, I need to know more than tell me I'm wonderful. Keep. Do we really like it when somebody's saying that to us? I don't. I'm sorry. If you come to me saying praise me, I'm sorry, I'm probably going to do the opposite. Right? Yeah. Did you notice what I did? Did you see the job that I did and how wonderful it was? Well, yeah, and remember I told you thanks? Yeah, but you didn't say thanks well enough. And so you guys say, is that the kind of God we have? No. We have a God who understands that as we start to praise him, as we start to acknowledge who he is, as we start to declare his greatness, it's about getting us out of this pit and starting to see life in a better and bigger kind of way. Praise is for us. So he says, sing praise. Incidentally, when he says, the word that's there, when you are happy, he says, when you are encouraged, when you are cheerful, that it's easier to sing praise then, isn't it? When you're already kind of cheery and you got an upbeat attitude, you know, okay, praise God. But don't forget that what Paul said in another place, he says, give thanks when? When everything's wonderful.
No, in everything.
Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of the Lord for you. So when you're suffering, pray. When you're happy, sing praise. He goes on and says, is anyone sick? It's an interesting word that he uses here when he asks if anyone is sick, because the word for sickness that's used here is sometimes translated sickness. In other places, it's actually translated weakness. He says, actually, in fact, if anyone is sick, if anyone is weak... It's interesting how that one comes out. If anyone's sick or weak, then you're supposed to call somebody, an elder, it says. Now, does that mean, so this church doesn't have elders, did you know that? So there's nobody to ask for prayer for here, right? We're in big trouble, aren't we? Because you know, the Bible says we're supposed to call for elders. But what's an elder? A presbyteros is the word that's used here. It's an older person. Incidentally, you need to realize that it says in 1 Timothy 5, 1 and 2, it says, do not rebuke an older man harshly, but exhort him as if he were your father. Treat younger men as brothers, older women as mothers, and younger women as sisters with absolute purity. And what's he using there? For the older women and the older men, he's calling them both presbyteros. You know, we have some people here, some ladies here that are on our prayer team. Why? Because they're intercessors. Does that make them, are we missing the text when we do that? I don't think so. Because we have older women who have a maturity in Jesus Christ, who have a commitment to prayer, who are willing to stop, and whether it's get on their knees or fall flat on their face before God, who are willing to lift up at a moment's notice someone else in need. And they do that because they believe that God responds to prayer. Those are presbyteros. And all of us have somebody who's more mature than us. You've got Bobby. No, it's the other way. We're not sure. So Bobby, you have David. No, guess what? You got Russ right there. Okay, we have somebody next to us, somebody that we can look to with some more spiritual maturity. They're saying, go to them and ask them for prayer. 1 Peter 5:5 says, in the same way, you who are younger, submit yourselves to your elders. All of you, clothe yourselves with humility toward one another, because God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble. Are you sick or weak? Humble yourself and allow somebody else to pray over you. Somebody with some amount of spiritual maturity who's going to be committed to putting you before God and listening to God with you. Ask them to pray over you. He goes on, he says, and to anoint with oil. Now, one theologian says that to anoint with oil meant you're supposed to rub them with oil. Okay, we're not going to open a massage parlor, I'm sorry. Well, yeah, a proper massage masseuse is going to use equipment, and they may use oil and stuff like that to do it, right? And I'm not talking about the bad kind of stuff, but the true person, Yoji Sato is a missionary. He has a school of theology in Japan, as well as he teaches and has a church here in Southern California. Yoji Sato, when he would come and pray for you. In the hospital, he'd lay hands on you. And as he'd pray, he'd give you some type of a massage. And he's sitting there and he's just praying God's anointing on you. And I don't know if some of you have noticed, but some of us have a bit of stress that's coming out in muscles. And so Yoji, as he, and this was just his ministry, and he did this, everybody he'd pray over, he'd come and lay hands on, he'd come in there, and Yoji would do some type of massage as he's praying for you. Now, I'm not recommending that that's what we should be doing, okay? But what I'm saying, there is this sense in which the text says that we're supposed to put oil on somebody. What's that about? Well, the oil, most believe, the oil is representative of the Holy Spirit. Don't get it wrong. The oil's not the Holy Spirit. It represents the Holy Spirit. It represents an anointing of the Holy Spirit. The oil was used throughout the Old Testament times. In fact, even Psalm 23 talks about anointing the head of the sheep with oil. What did you do that for? Now, in this case, you pour oil all over their head. Why? Because the oil was meant to keep the flies away from their face so that the flies would not nest there and cause sickness and stuff like that. And in fact, Jesus even talked about this, didn't he? He talked about the woman who comes into the house and he says, and she's pouring oil all over his feet. It's a perfumed kind of oil. And Jesus says to the Pharisee, the leader there of the home, he says, you know, look, who's criticizing him that she's wasting all this money by pouring all this oil on his feet. And he says, you know, look, since I came in here, you didn't put oil on my head, which is what you're supposed to do when somebody comes into your house when they've been out on the street and you welcome them in, you put oil on their head. It was not shampoo, but it was kind of like, in a sense, giving you this protection. And besides, you're out on the street, you're in the dusty roads, and what's happening? Your skin's getting all dry, isn't it? So oil was that kind of a thing. It was a healing agent, even. In this case, he's saying, look, anoint with oil. It's a symbol that the Holy Spirit is anointing and blessing this person. Do you believe that the Holy Spirit heals today? That God gives miracles? See, here's the challenge, because our text goes on to say, call the elders of the church to pray over him and anoint him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise him up. Has everybody been healed that you've prayed for? If you're standing up here like I am, you'd be seeing that there are several people shaking their head no. Has everybody been healed that Pastor Bill has prayed for? No. So then what do we do in response to that? Well, then, unfortunately, what we too often say is, well, somebody didn't have faith. Somebody was messed up. It was something wrong with one of them, because look, we have this text that here, right here, says you pray, you anoint, and the person will be healed, period. So if they weren't, well, then obviously something was wrong with one of the prayers. Really? Because I see a number of times in Scripture where Jesus healed people and they didn't actually have faith. You know, now there might be somebody in the scene that did, but there are oftentimes those who didn't. In fact, might be wailing in the room and saying, you know, what's he going in there praying over that dead body for? It's not coming back. So there's all kinds of times where people don't have faith, and yet God still gives a miracle. The challenge is that, how do we know when? Well, you see, in order to know when, you've got to talk to God. Sometimes we just run in, ask for the healing, and run back out without ever saying, God, what do you want for this person? They're saying, pray for this. They're saying they have this physical need, and they need healed of it, cancer, whatever it might be. But God, what do they really need? Do they need physical healing? I'm going to ask, because it's kind of helpful to ask from the desires of our heart. God says he'll respond to that. But what I start trying to do is, God, what do they need? Is that what's most important? And if we'll stop and listen to God, we'll find that God's going to give a miracle. And it may be a lot better than the physical healing that we're asking them for, him for. So he says, pray. And believe, and anoint with oil. And then the text moves to the part that we don't want to include. If he has sinned, he will be forgiven. How many times you've prayed for somebody to be healed and you prayed about their sin? So often we're not. We're simply praying about the physical healing they're requesting. But notice, and be careful here. Does Jesus believe that all sickness is caused by sin? Injury, all caused by sin, right? Well, some of it is, right? I do something stupid, I run into a post there, it's kind of like a sin, isn't it? I missed the mark, it's a failure, right? I'm going too fast, I crash my car. Okay, that's a sin, isn't it? However, not all sickness is caused by sin. Jesus even points that out. He says, when they're asking him, the young man, you know, which one of them sinned, the kid or the parents? And Jesus says what? None of them. Now, that was a totally new and revolutionary thought for the Pharisees and the Jews and the leaders of the religious people, because they thought all sin, all illness was caused by somebody's sin. He says, no, none of them. This was done so that God could show himself to us. God was at work in this. Oh, wow. But notice, most of us, when we're going to pray for somebody, we don't pray about their sin, do we? Because look at the rest of the text then. It says, if a person has sinned, they will be forgiven. He goes on. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous man is powerful and effective. He says, confess. The word homologeo, confess, means to agree with God. Well, that's an interesting view. Not agree with your neighbor, but this is about agreeing with God on his view of things, his view of what you or someone else has done. When you're confessing, you're saying, God, I agree with you. You said this is sin. You said this is wrong. I've just blown it. Peter's back there in the back of the room. Grandpa, wave here. Wave. Now, what's interesting, in our text, the normal word for confess, 1 John 1:9, if we confess, if we agree with God, he is faithful and righteous to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. The word that we have here is not homologeo, it's ex-homologeo. In other words, it's more than homologeo. It's more than just agreeing with God. It's if you extra agree with God. In order to do that, he says, you got to do that out in the open. You got to confess your faults one to another. So what we should start doing is every Sunday, we should take the first half an hour and have people stand up here in line and confess all the sins they've done for the week in front of everybody, right? Some of you are saying, looking for another church as quick as I can. No, that's not what the text says. The text does not say, stand up in front and tell everybody your sins. Okay? We don't need to give glory to sin. But what the text does say is that we need to come out of the dark, and we need to get with somebody else a little bit more mature, and we need to go ahead and be honest and agree with God and confess our sins to someone else. Who do I trust with my sin? Who am I going to tell my sins? You know, well, fortunately, I'm a pastor, and pastors aren't supposed to have friends with people in the church, so, oh well, I'm off that one. Really? This is probably one of the biggest reasons why we're not building the relationships with one another that God wants us to build. It's hindering us from being all that God wants us to be out in this community. Because here's the fact. Have you ever noticed one of the criticisms that people play on the church? It's full of hypocrites. Yeah, what else is new? Okay, everybody wears masks. Everybody's imperfect. Yeah, so the church is full of hypocrites. Where else should they go? Ah, but what they're also saying is, you know, we see in them sin. Christians have sin. They blow it. They make mistakes. Yes. We're not saying we're perfect, are we? But what we're saying is that God cares about us and loves us and wants to help us break free of our sin if we'll face it. Here's somebody who would say this. Well, I just go to God. Why do I need to confess to somebody else? Why do I need to open up my sin for somebody else to see, especially if they already see it? Because I'm going to go straight to the one himself, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, Master of the universe. I'm going to just go talk to him. Okay. If I can talk to the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the one who is perfect and righteous and holy and just and who could burn me up in my sin, then what's wrong with going to the friend who is not near as holy? Why couldn't I go to them? You see, maybe when I think I'm going to God, I'm not. If I haven't been willing to be honest in front of somebody who's just as sinful as me. Well, I don't know, you're maybe not as sinful as me, but we confess our faults, our sins, our wrongs, our deliberate actions that go against God's will. We confess them to one another. And then, James says, and the prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. And it's interesting that the word that's used there is energeo. It's the word we use for energy. It's energize. You're probably doing what I'm doing, thinking about the Energizer Buddy, right? Prayer is energized. It's anointed. It's empowered when we confess our faults one to another. You break down with somebody. You open up. You're honest with somebody. And it's amazing what God does when you then agree with that person. Are you willing to be honest with someone else? Incidentally, you look at any of the 12-step programs, what are they all built on? This very fact, that they will be honest, that they're going to talk openly with somebody else, and they're going to find grace and acceptance and challenge and exhortation and all those kinds of things from those someone else's, because they start getting honest. Well, shouldn't it happen in the body of Christ? Do you need prayer today? Are you suffering? Are you sick? Do you need prayer from someone else? Let's pray. God, I thank you that we don't have to fake it. I thank you that you accept us the way we are. I pray, God, that we will learn the incredible power that's available if we will humble ourselves, confess our faults, and pray. I pray, Lord, for things that you may want to do right here, right now, and people that are here today. I pray that you would meet their needs according to your riches, not by our limited view of things. I pray that you would increase our faith, God. And Lord, come. Come speak to us. even if that means pointing out the stuff, God, that we've been trying to hide, the sin we've been trying to ignore, the habits we've been trying to say are okay, the dark spots that have been wrong. And they're not about Satan, they're not about demons, they're not about anything else. It's about us and our choices. It's our sin. Come, God, show that stuff to us and make us into new people. And thank you, God, that you've promised to forgive and cleanse us. And Lord, I just praise you for that. In Jesus' name.